Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the last lecture, we saw how ancient people came up with the idea of fractions as a way to represent numbers between 0 and 1. At first, the only type of fractions used were unit fractions, 1/2, 1/3, 1/4, and so on. The denominator of a unit fraction, which we will represent by the letter Q, can be any natural number, but the numerator must be 1. Eventually, unit fractions were replaced with common fractions. The numerator of a common fraction can be any integer, which we will represent by the letter P. When representing the value of a fraction on the number line, the denominator specifies how many equal parts each unit length is subdivided into, and the numerator specifies the number of those subdivisions in the fraction. Using the number line, we can visualize arithmetic operations with fractions in much the same way we visualize arithmetic operations with integers. Integers are represented as multiples of the unit length. However, to represent fractions, we use multiples of the subdivisions determined by their denominators. For example, if we add the fractions 3/5 and 4/5, we use 5 subdivisions per unit length, since these fractions both have denominators of 5. Each subdivision is 1/5 of a unit. The fraction 3/5 represents 3 of these subdivisions, and the fraction 4/5 represents 4 subdivisions. Therefore, the total length adds up to 7 subdivisions, or 7/5. If we subtract 4/5 from 3/5, we start out at a position of 3 subdivisions to the right of the origin, and then move 4 subdivisions to the left. We end up 1 subdivision to the left of the origin at negative 1/5. If we want to multiply an integer times a fraction, for example, 4 times 3/5, this is the same as adding 3/5 4 times. On the number line, we can see that this adds up to 12/5. Multiplying an integer times a fraction doesn't change the size of the subdivisions, so the denominator is not affected. We simply multiply 4 times the numerator 3 to get the numerator of the result. So when multiplying an integer and a fraction, we multiply the integer times the fraction's numerator. For example, to multiply 3 times 1/5, we multiply 3 times the numerator, 1, which gives us 3/5. Likewise, 5 times 2/3 is 5 times the numerator, 2, or 10/3. What happens when we multiply a fraction times a fraction? We can visualize this by starting with a square, with a height and width of 1 unit. The area of a square is equal to its height times its width. So this square has an area of 1. Now if we divide the square into 4 equal pieces, each piece will have an area of 1/4. Since the height and width of each piece is 1/2, we can see that 1/2 times 1/2 is 1/4. If we divide the square into thirds horizontally, we will have 6 equal pieces, each with an area of 1/6. Since each piece has a height of 1/2 and the width of 1/3, we see that 1/2 times 1/3 is 1/6. Likewise, if we divide the square into thirds horizontally and vertically, we will have 9 equal pieces, each with an area of 1/9. Since each piece has a height and width of 1/3, we see that 1/3 times 1/3 is 1/9. Notice that in each case when we multiplied two fractions, we could have obtained the denominators of the result by multiplying the denominators of the two fractions. So to multiply two unit fractions, we multiply their denominators. As an example, to multiply the fractions 1/3 times 1/7, we multiply the denominators 3 and 7. So the product of these two fractions is 1/21. But what if instead of multiplying two unit fractions, we want to multiply two common fractions? When multiplying common fractions, the numerators are multiplied, creating the product's numerator, and the denominators are multiplied, creating the product's denominator. But why does this work? We can see the reason if we use a series of small steps that we already know work. Let's start over and do this one step at a time. We'll start by splitting each common fraction into an integer times a unit fraction. Using the commutative property of multiplication, we can rearrange the factors. And using the associative property, we can group the two integers and the two unit fractions. As we saw, the two unit fractions are multiplied by multiplying their denominators. So now we have the product n times p, which is an integer, times the unit fraction 1 over m times q. To multiply an integer times a unit fraction, we multiply the integer times the numerator. Of course, n times p times 1 is just n times p. So when multiplying two common fractions, the numerators are multiplied, creating the product's numerator, and the denominators are multiplied, creating the product's denominator. Let's do this one more time. But instead of using letters, which can represent any integers, we'll use specific numbers. Once again, we start by splitting each common fraction into an integer times a unit fraction. Then, using the commutative and associative properties, we rearrange the factors so that the two numbers which were the numerators are grouped together and the two unit fractions are grouped together. We then multiply the unit fractions by multiplying their denominators. And we multiply the 2 and 5, which were the numerators. Of course, 10 times 1/21 is 10/21. So to multiply the fractions 2/3 times 5/7, we can just take the shortcut of multiplying the numerators 2 and 5 and the denominators 3 and 7. And the result is 10/21. This rule works for any type of fraction. If the fractions are unit fractions, multiplying the numerators and the denominators still gives us the correct result. So multiplying fractions is simple. We multiply the numerators and the denominators. In the next lecture, we will see how to divide fractions.